Connor, about 140 years ago, the City of Glasgow Bank failed, and this was described at the time as a calamity so huge and disastrous that it riveted men's gaze and made their hearts stand still. So why was this event so important?
Well, the failure of City of Glasgow Bank was a huge event at the time. It was actually the UK's largest commercial banking failure prior to the recent financial crisis. The episode also led to a number of considerable changes to the UK banking system, some of which endure to today. And a number of the issues raised by the bank's failure are relevant to today's policy debates.
So what happened?
In October 1878, City of Glasgow Bank's investors started to lose confidence in the bank. And when it was revealed that losses had been fraudulently concealed at the bank on a grand scale, the liquidity assistance that the bank had sought from other Scottish banks were denied. Largely due to losses on exposures to a small group of borrowers, branded by the Times as a desperate gang of adventurers, the bank was deemed to be deeply insolvent and forced to close. Following a trial, which attracted great public and media attention, a number of the bank's directors were sent to prison for up to 18 months, only the second time in history that directors of a British bank had been sent to prison.
Now, your article explains that given all of this, the impact was relatively contained in many respects, but not so for the bank's shareholders.
Yeah, that's right. If you invest in a company today, the worst that can happen is that you lose the entire value of your initial investment. This is known as limited liability because the amount you can lose is limited to the amount you invest. However, at the time of City of Glasgow Bank's failure, many investors in banks were subject to unlimited liability. This meant that they were liable to all the losses incurred by the bank, even beyond the initial investment that they'd made.
What was the impact on the bank shareholders then?
Well, given unlimited liability and the scale of the losses incurred at the bank, the demands placed on shareholders were very great indeed. To put it in context, the first call on shareholders per share was equal to almost four times the annual salary of a teacher at the time. Interestingly though, despite the scale of the financial hardship, there's little evidence of shareholders trying to avoid payment, and there's even some reports of shareholders travelling to Glasgow in person to make the payments to the liquidators. The plight of these investors did cause a lot of sympathy at the time. For example, a relief fund was established which raised almost £380,000, including through a public recital of the works of Shakespeare.
And you mentioned that all of this had a very enduring impact.
Indeed, I think one of the most important consequences was the move away from unlimited liability to limited liability for UK banks across the board. As this chart shows, following the aftermath of City of Glasgow Bank's failure, by 1889 there were barely any UK banks that still operated under the model of unlimited liability. What's more, this change was arguably a prerequisite for the wave of mergers which took place amongst commercial banks in the late 19th century. The idea being that under the old model of unlimited liability, investors would be reluctant to invest in very large banks where the potential losses could be so great. The move away from unlimited liability may have paved the way for the emergence of a highly concentrated banking sector, much like the one we have today.
I see. Now, your article also draws a number of parallels between this episode of financial history and the recent financial crisis.
That's right, and it also considers lessons for financial policymakers today.
Excellent. Connor, thanks very much.
Thank you.